If you're in your 40s or 50s, in perimenopause or menopause, and you keep waking up thinking, why is my fasting blood sugar higher when I barely ate last night? This is for you. Because in this video, I'm gonna show you exactly what's driving those stubborn high morning numbers during perimenopause and what you can start doing today to bring them down in a safe, sustainable, science-backed way. We'll talk about what's happening in your liver overnight, how perimenopause hormones can cause morning highs, the three levers you can pull, food, timing, and movement to lower fasting glucose, and how to do all of this without starving yourself, cutting all carbs, or wrecking your sleep. If you want recipes and meal ideas that follow this exact strategy, comment guide below and we'll send you our free low-fat, plant-based recipe guide. Let's start with what's actually happening in your body before you even open your eyes. Most people think, my fasting blood sugar is high, it must be what I ate right before bed. That's part of it. But the real story is deeper, especially for women in perimenopause. All night long, your body still needs fuel for your brain, for your heart, your muscles. So your liver acts like a slow glucose IV, dripping small amounts of sugar into your bloodstream to keep you alive. In a healthy, insulin-sensitive liver, that drip is controlled and gentle. Morning blood sugar might rise a little from, say, the 80s to low 90s and then settle. But when your liver is storing too much fat, it becomes insulin resistant. Now, you must understand that insulin is also known as a messenger hormone. The messages that insulin carries are extremely important to keep your blood sugar in check. In the early morning hours, insulin tells your liver, hey, we've got enough glucose in the blood. You can stop now. But when the liver has too much fat inside, the liver doesn't listen. It keeps dumping glucose into your bloodstream, even when you don't need it. That's what pushes your fasting numbers into the 110s, 120s, 130s, or higher. So what does perimenopause have to do with this? The truth is that for most women, blood sugar levels get all out of whack right around that time menopause hits. So now you have to layer perimenopause on top of insulin resistance. As estrogen levels start fluctuating and eventually decline, several things happen that directly affect your blood sugar. Your fat distribution shifts from hips and thighs toward more abdominal and visceral fat, the deep fat around your organs and liver. Visceral fat releases more free fatty acids directly into the portal vein, the blood vessel going straight to your liver, which can worsen liver fat and insulin resistance. Sleep often gets worse. Night sweats, early awakenings, lighter sleep. Poor sleep raises cortisol, and higher cortisol tells your liver to release even more glucose. So, if you're thinking, things were fine in my 30s, and now in my late 40s, everything feels harder. You're not imagining it. The hormonal shifts of perimenopause do make you more prone to liver fat, visceral belly fat, insulin resistance, higher fasting glucose. But that does not mean you're doomed. It means you need a strategy tailored to what your body is doing now, not what it did at 25. So let's talk about what actually works. Method number one, lower liver fat without starving or going keto. If high fasting blood sugar is largely a liver problem, then the first step is to de-fat the liver, not by eating zero carbs, not by adding more butter or MCT oil, but by changing what kind of fat and how much fat you eat. In a controlled feeding study published in Diabetes, researchers overfed healthy adults with muffins made from either saturated fat, palm oil, or polyunsaturated fat, sunflower oil. Calories were matched, so both groups gained the same amount of weight. What happened? The saturated fat group experienced a significant increase in liver fat, while the polyunsaturated fat group showed almost no increase. They also gained more visceral fat, the fat most strongly linked to insulin resistance. These changes were independent of overall weight gain, meaning the type of fat, not the amount of food, drove the difference. This pattern is similar to what we often see in perimenopause. Changes in fat storage patterns, more visceral fat, and greater sensitivity to dietary saturated fat. So if your fasting numbers are high, the very first lever to pull is drop saturated fat way down. This means minimizing red meat and processed meat, cheese, butter, cream, coconut oil, palm oil, high fat animal protein in general, and replacing those calories with low fat, high fiber plant foods, beans and lentils, whole grains like millet, barley, brown rice, fruits, starchy vegetables like potatoes and sweet potatoes, tons of greens, and non-starchy veggies. This combination does two things for your perimenopausal metabolism: clears the fat deposits from your liver and improves insulin sensitivity in your muscles so they can pull more glucose out of your blood during the day and overnight. If your energy is up and down, hot flashes are rough, and you're juggling work, family, and hormones, the last thing you need is a miserable, restrictive diet. That's why I'm not telling you to eat less. I'm telling you to eat differently. Big portions, high fiber, very low saturated fat. So you feel full, have more stable energy, and slowly chip away at liver fat in the background. If you want recipes that follow this exact pattern, comment guide and we'll send them to you. Method number two, fix the timing. The perimenopause-friendly dawn strategy. Next piece of the puzzle, when you eat. In perimenopause, sleep is often more fragile. You might wake up hot at 2 or 3 a.m., have trouble falling back asleep, feel wired, tired at bedtime. All of that pushes cortisol higher and makes your liver more likely to overproduce glucose overnight. So, we want to stack the deck in your favor by giving your liver a real rest window, avoiding a huge dinner plus late night snacking, working with your hormones, not against them. That's where time-restricted eating comes into place, but gentle. I'm not asking you to do extreme fasting. For most perimenopausal women, that backfires. Too hungry, more stress, worse sleep. Instead, think of a gentle 12 to 14 hour overnight window where you finish dinner by 6:30 to 7 p.m. You're done snacking by then. You eat breakfast around 7:30 to 9 a.m. That's it. You're simply moving your calories earlier in the day, giving your insulin a chance to drop overnight, letting your liver burn through stored glycogen and fat instead of juggling a big late night meal. Clinical studies of early time-restricted feeding show improvements in insulin sensitivity, fasting glucose, and even blood pressure without eating less overall. A perimenopause tweak. Because your sleep may already be fragile, here are ways to make this doable. Anchor dinner at a consistent time. Your body loves rhythm during hormone changes. Keep dinner lighter and lower in fat than lunch. Less oil, less cheese, less dessert. If you must have something later, make it small and low fat, like a piece of fruit or a small baked potato, no nuts or ice cream. Think of this like giving your liver an earlier shift end so it can clock out and clean up instead of working overtime all night. Method number three, move in a way your hormones love, not hate. Movement is one of the most powerful tools to lower fasting glucose, especially when hormones are shifting. But perimenopause comes with joint stiffness, heavier or irregular periods, fatigue, pelvic floor changes. So the answer is not to punish yourself with brutal, high-intensity interval training 6 days a week. Zone 2 movement for liver and visceral fat. What works remarkably well and is kinder to your nervous system is zone 2 exercise. You can breathe through your nose, you can speak in full sentences, your heart rate is elevated, but you're not gasping. Think brisk walking, gentle cycling, easy swimming, elliptical at a moderate pace. Studies in people with fatty liver disease show that moderate intensity aerobic exercise several times per week can significantly reduce liver fat and improve insulin sensitivity even when body weight doesn't change. That's huge for perimenopause because many women notice the scale barely budges, but my labs can still improve. And that's exactly what we want. Better fasting glucose, better A1C, better liver enzymes, even if the scale is slow. Here's how to apply this in real life. Aim for 30 to 40 minutes of zone 2 training, 4 to 5 days per week, plus 2 days of simple resistance training to preserve muscle mass. Think bodyweight squats, wall push-ups, or light dumbbells. Muscle is your best friend in perimenopause. It soaks up glucose like a sponge, it stabilizes joints, it protects your bones. If mornings are busy, try a 10 to 15 minute walk after dinner to blunt your post-meal glucose and help your liver overnight. 2 or 3 10 minute walks after each meal instead of one long session. This is not about training for a marathon. This is about churning your muscles into glucose sinks so your fasting numbers stop creeping up. Now, what about the moment you actually see that high number on your meter? Here's exactly what to do, especially through perimenopause. Step 1, don't panic or punish fast. A high reading can trigger, "That's it, I'm not eating till noon." For some people, that just makes stress and cortisol worse, especially if you're already underslept and hormonally sensitive. Instead, think, okay, what can I do to help my liver today? Step 2, hydrate first. Perimenopause often comes with night sweats and more fluid loss, which means mild dehydration in the morning. Dehydration can concentrate your glucose in your blood and make readings look higher and feel worse. So start your day with a big glass of water, 12 to 16 ounces, optional, a squeeze of lemon for taste and a small bump in potassium. Hydration helps your kidneys filter glucose, supports blood volume, and makes movement easier. Step 3, light and gentle movement. Get natural light in your eyes within the first hour after waking without staring directly at the sun. This helps reset your circadian rhythm, stabilize cortisol, improve sleep later that night, which feeds back into better fasting glucose. Pair that with 10 minutes of easy movement, walking around the block, marching in place, or a few light mobility exercises. You're sending a message to your body. The day has started. We're safe, we're moving, use this glucose. Step 4, eat a low-fat, high-fiber breakfast. Don't skip it by default. For many perimenopausal women, a small, balanced breakfast actually improves blood sugar later in the day compared to white-knuckling it until noon. Think quinoa with berries and ground flax, a big fruit bowl plus a side of steamed greens, leftover beans, and rice with greens. What's important is very low fat, very high fiber, no cheese, butter, coconut oil, or heavy cream. You want breakfast to help your muscles take up glucose, not add more fat to your liver, and keep you stable till lunch. We can't talk about morning blood sugar and perimenopause without talking about sleep and stress. One rough night, especially if you were hot, restless, or anxious, can make you 30 to 40% more insulin resistant the next day in some studies. And women in perimenopause are more likely to experience fragmented sleep, night sweats, early morning awakening, all of which translate into higher cortisol, more liver glucose output, higher fasting numbers. Here's what you can actually do. You don't need a perfect 8 hours to see a benefit. Focus on small changes that your hormones will love. Cool, dark bedroom, a fan, lighter bedding, or a cooling pillow can make night sweats less disruptive. No heavy, high-fat dinner. Large, late, fatty meals are a perfect recipe for reflux, poor sleep, and worse fasting numbers. Wind down ritual, 15 to 20 minutes of anything that signals day is done. Stretching, legs up the wall, a short breathing practice, or reading a real book. If you're lowering saturated fat, moving earlier in the day, and getting even a modest improvement in sleep quality, your liver will start behaving more calmly at night, and your fasting readings will show it. Let's recap this in a way you can actually use tomorrow morning. If you're in your 40s or 50s, peri or postmenopause, and your fasting blood sugar is stubbornly high, here's your roadmap. Lower saturated fat to drain liver fat. Minimize meat, cheese, butter, cream, coconut oil. Base your meals on fruits, whole grains, beans, lentils, potatoes, and tons of vegetables. This directly targets liver fat and insulin resistance, the root of those morning highs. Shift your eating window a bit earlier. Finish dinner by 6:30 to 7 p.m. when you can. Avoid heavy late night snacks. Aim for a 12 to 14 hour overnight window that works with your sleep, not against it. Use zone 2 movement and target liver and visceral fat. 30 to 40 minutes of brisk walking or similar, 4 to 5 days a week. Add 2 days of simple strength training to protect muscle and bones. Build a morning routine that calms, not stresses. Hydrate, get light, move gently, eat a low-fat, high-fiber breakfast instead of reacting with a punishing fast. Respect the hormone, sleep, glucose triangle. Cool the room, lighten dinner, use a small wind-down ritual to lower evening stress. When you combine these, lower saturated fat, higher fiber, earlier eating, smart movement, and kinder sleep, you're not just chasing numbers. You're addressing the real reasons fasting blood sugar rises in perimenopause. More visceral and liver fat, more overnight glucose output, more cortisol from poor sleep. And you're doing it in a way that's aligned with how your body works now in this stage of life. If you want help putting this into actual breakfasts, lunches, and dinners with recipes that are low in saturated fat, high in fiber, and designed to improve insulin sensitivity, comment guide below and we'll send you our free recipe guide. You don't have to starve, you don't have to fear carbs, and you don't have to accept that this is just menopause. You can absolutely lower your morning blood sugar and feel better in your body again, starting with what you do today. If this video helped you, hit the like button, subscribe to our channel, and share it with somebody ready to improve their blood sugar. Until next time, keep those carbs high and that A1C low.